Father in heaven, I thank you again that we can study your word. I pray you, that you may continue to be with us and that you may speak to our hearts and help us, Lord, to understand how the mystery of God relates to the great controversy and the end times and how we can apply it to our lives. That's my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. So, yeah, this is really one of my favorite topics, I must say, with the theme of it, because this is one of the last things that will take place before Jesus comes back. And, well, I hope you'll discover, as a result, why it is important and how it fits to the great controversy. Let's go quickly to Revelation 10, just give you a little bit of background. Revelation 10 says there in verse 1, I saw still another mighty angel coming down from heaven, clothed with a cloud, and a rainbow was on his head. His face was like the sun, and his feet like the pillars of fire. Who are we talking about here? Who is this? Is Jesus, right? You see, this description is similar to Revelation 1, where we got the description, which is similar to the when Daniel saw this man in Daniel chapter 10. So this, again, this is Jesus. And Ellen White confirms that also in the Bible commentary. And we see, well, you have some references here, Revelation 4:3. You see some similarities. Okay. He had a little book open in his hand, and he set his right foot on the sea and his left foot on the land, and cried with a loud voice, as when a lion roars. When he cried out, seven thunders uttered their voices. Now when the seven thunders uttered their voices, I was about to write, but I heard a voice from heaven saying to me, seal up the things which the seven thunders uttered, and do not write them. The angel whom I saw standing on the sea and on the land raised up his hand to heaven, and swore by him who lives forever and ever, who created heaven and the things that are in it, the earth and the things that are in it, and the sea and the things that are in it, that there should be delay or time no longer. Okay, so there's a specific time here, and we will take a look at the time later, but I'm sure some of you have know what time this is. There will be time no longer. It will be a time in history where there will not, after this point, there will be no more prophetic or timeline or prophecies based upon time. Verse 7, here's a key text. But in the days of the sounding of the seventh angel, when he is about to sound, the mystery of God would be finished, as he declared to his servants the prophets. Okay, so when the seventh trumpet is sounding, is about to sound, the mystery of God would be finished. Is this describing an event or a project? What do you think, based on verse 7? Look at verse 7 and think, is it an event or is this a project, rather? Well, yeah, well, when I say event, I mean this is something happening, bam, and done. It looks more like something that takes place over time, and at least that's my point. Because something is to be finished, so it's a project that takes some time. How long time? We don't know. What? Mm-hmm. So, we will see what significance this topic has in relating to the great controversy. Yeah, I talked, we have talked about the seven churches, the seven seals, seven trumpets briefly, that they are throughout history. And this is the seventh trumpet we're dealing with. So, the great controversy, how did it start? Starting in heaven, right? Satan and then his angels were fighting against God. And they were fighting against God. Why? They didn't think he was just. They were unsure about his character and said, look, God is not really the one who is claiming to be. So it's about God's character, God's commandments, which reflect his character. God is love, and the devil didn't really think that God was just still. In Isaiah chapter 14, let's go there and take a look at, you know, what is the devil really made of? What can we find out from these texts? Isaiah 14, verse 13 and 14. Yasmin, would you like to read it? And could someone give a microphone to Yasmin? I don't know where it is. Oh, there. Okay. Isaiah 14, verse 13 and 14.
For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven, I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High.
Okay, thank you. Is this a verse that you are going to memorize? Do you know? When I went to Africa, we were actually memorizing this text. But anyhow, you see in here, I want to do this, I'm going to do this, and it's me. So, you see the nature of selfishness here. This is talking, of course, about the devil, and he thought he had a better idea on things. And we also find the same characteristics in Antichrist, that he wants, I'm going to change these laws, change these times, you know. We have the authority to change God's word. That's what they're saying. It's, you know, it's us, it's we. We want to do this. They put themselves above God. Which, of course, the devil is working through this, so we could expect the same, you know, characteristics, in a sense. So we see the rebellion started in heaven, but it's carried down here on earth. And what was it that we saw, you know, well, what Satan said in the book of Genesis, the first lies that came? Has God really said that you shall not eat of this, all these trees? You shall not die. We have the first lie, right? You shall not die. For God knows that in the day you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. So man fell into sin, and the earth became a central part of the great controversy. A very, you know, this is where it's all focused right now. And is the universe watching us? Is the universe taking place? Do the angels, have they had questions? At this point in history, I had lots of questions still to be answered. We know that many, a big part of the angels were thrown out of heaven together with Satan. In 1 Corinthians 4, verse 9, we have read this before, but now in a little bit different context. For I think that God has set forth us, the apostles, last, as it were appointed to death, for we are made a spectacle, or a theater, unto the world, and to angels, and to men. This earth is the theater scene of the great controversy. All are closely following to what is taking place here. Why? Because the great controversy is not ended yet. They are following to see what is going to happen. Will God be able to restore man? Of course, they can trust in God's promises, but you know, they are following us. What is taking place here? So our life has, it serves another purpose, more than just living here for ourselves. It serves a great purpose, and Satan wants to destroy as much as he can. But something is we are to reveal something to the universe. When I was at the age of 11, when I went to school, we were gonna sing some songs, and in front of a lot of people, and I was so nervous. All the guys were forced to sing solo. I didn't like that. I was so nervous, but we had to sing solo. We had no choice, and I didn't want to do it, but I had to. So we were standing here with candles, and the oxygen getting less and less, and now it was my turn to sing. I started singing, and my heart just beating so fast, and I think, oh man, I started feeling bad. And suddenly I couldn't sing any longer. My voice just stopped. And everyone was looking at me. I was at the theater scene. Suddenly, a teacher comes up and takes me down. And, come on, come. She saw that I was about to faint. She took me down. If not, I would have fainted there. But I was actually literally at the theater scene doing this. And everyone was following. I stopped singing and everyone looked at me. And I was so embarrassed, right? And I couldn't do anything. I was about to faint. I didn't understand what was going on. She helped me down. But, you know, we are at the theater scene. People are closely following us. What is going on? And our actions. So we need to realize our lives are playing an important role in the finishing of this great controversy. Many things have happened so far. So many key points. Jesus came down to this earth, died at the cross. The prophecies, many of the prophecies have been taking place. We are at the very end of it. Let's take a brief look at the nature of Christ. I know we have had big discussions about this. I'm just going to give some verses on this. Because this is related to our topic. You will see clear. So let's go to 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. 1 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. It says, "And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up in glory." Like I said, Christ came, or God came down to this earth in the flesh. He came and took up on himself humanity. So divinity was manifest in humanity through Christ. Divinity was manifest in humanity. So the mystery is revealed in humanity through Jesus. At this point, we can see that so far. The mystery of godliness, which we read in Revelation, the mystery of God. God manifest in the flesh. Okay, Philippians 2, verses 5 to 8. It says, "Let this mind be in you, which also was in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself, and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also has highly exalted him, and given him a name which is above every name." We saw in the last class that Jesus in heaven, he gave up his honor and glory, came down, took upon himself humanity. So he gave up his nature. He came and took humanity after it was filled with sin for 4,000 years. And sin is the transgression of the law. But he took upon himself a sinful nature. Yet he did not sin. And let's see in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 17. And we'll read 18 as well. We have 17 here on the screen. Therefore, in all things, he had to be made like his brethren, in all things, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in the things pertaining to God, to make propitiation for the sins of the people. For in that he himself has suffered being tempted, he is able to aid those who are tempted. So, it says, he had to be like his brothers. Who are Jesus' brothers? In Matthew 12, verse 49, he's pointing at the disciples and says, here are my mother and my brothers. These are the ones he became, he was made like in all things, as it says. So, we as humans, we have a propensity to sin. We are tempted to do sin. He became like us. But Jesus did not sin. He was tempted like us. So this is, of course, fantastic news, because that Christ did not fall. He is an example for us and show us what we need to do in him. Hebrews 4:15, for we have not an high priest which cannot be touched with the feeling of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like as we are, yet without sin. Romans 1, chapter 3, I had it there. Concerning his son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, which was made in the seed of David according to the flesh. According to the sinful nature, sarx in Greek. And here, Lewis states from Desire of Ages, page 48. It would have been an almost infinite humiliation for the Son of God to take man's nature, even when Adam stood in his innocence in Eden. But Jesus accepted humanity when the race had been weakened by 4,000 years of sin. Like every child of Adam, he accepted the results of the workings of the great law of heredity. What these results were is shown in the history of his earthly ancestors. He came with such a heredity to share our sorrows and temptations and to give us the example of a sinless life. So, he came with such a heredity after humanity was weakened for 4,000 years of sin. And to give us an example for sin, how to live a sinless life, as he did, because he did not sin. God was manifested in humanity. Divinity was manifested in Christ as a man and show us what we may become through God. A few more quotes. Well, this is a big topic, but I will not take so much more time, but it's connected, so I have to say something about it. The great work of redemption could be carried out only by the Redeemer taking the place of fallen Adam. He had the same nature as the sinner. And you can look up these quotes if you want in context. Anyhow, so Christ gave up his glory and honor in heaven, came down to this dark earth, was tempted like us, lived like us, and ultimately he died for us. What a mystery. This is the mystery of God. What a merciful God we serve. He proved perfect love in the person of Christ. You know, if we are unsure about the love of God, when we read the Old Testament, all horrible things that happen, or whatever it is, look to Christ. Because if we study part of the Bible without keeping Christ and his sacrifice in the center, we will fail to understand. We will fail to understand the hard, so to speak, the hard stories of the Old Testament. But with Christ in mind, it should make sense. That should show us the love of God. If we are unsure, look to Christ. imagine that you're a part of an athletic club and you're going to run 100 meters hurdle is when you jump over these things. And things start to go not so well for your club, and the coach is a little bit worried about the results. And one day he said, look, I'm going to show you how to do it. Look at me. I'm going to show you an example. And he stands at the starting line. And suddenly you see he has something strange at his back. And he's just going very fast. He has a jet motor on his back. And you're like, and he says, look, I want you to do the same thing now. And you're like, are you kidding me? You're different. I mean, you're not like us. We can't do that. Would it make sense that Christ had a totally different nature than us and say, look, this is, I am your example. You know, be my guest. Try to follow me. And that wouldn't make sense. That doesn't make sense to me at all. That he would have some kind of super nature that, I mean, that does not make sense. That's not an example. I mean, because we can't reach the standard. We don't have that nature. So why? I mean, how can that make sense? Not to me. So if Christ is our example on earth, it would not make sense that he would have a different nature than us. And it's only by Christ and his example, his sacrifice, that it is possible for us to follow his example. Okay, let's... Yeah, well, we could discuss on that, but I know you already have, so... I don't think we will keep discussing at this point. Unless you really want, but we will miss the topic because... Yeah, it's a lot of things to say, I guess. Well, we can see if we have time later, if you want. But what it says in this text that we have read, or and the quote, in this heredity of 4,000 years, that's when it took. That's the nature of what he took, like we saw in the quote. And yeah, I know it's there are. I don't know how many views I've heard now of the nature of Christ. I just keep hearing more and more. Before I heard there are two different. Now I know that there are at least three, four, or even more versions of the nature of Christ or what he had. Because, like I understood Alan Davis has pointed out, I mean, it's all boils down. I mean, it has such a big different outcome on what you believe about the nature of Christ and what you believe of sin and what sin is. There are some. Within our church, they believe that there are more than one kinds of sin. There is one sin that we are born with, and we're just born like that. Because we're born like that, we can't have victory over it, because we are born like that. And then Christ cannot have our nature, because he cannot sin. So, and this is a thought that comes from the original sin, which is believed in among other Christians. I can see the biblical. I can see the definition of sin is the transgression of the law, 1 John 3:4. So there is. I don't believe there is more than one kind of sin. It all boils down to is the transgression of the law. And then you have two other texts that are stating, for he who knows to do good, and does not do it, for him it is sin. And then you have a third one. Let's see, how was it? Did you start? Right now I can't think of it. You have it in James, and you have it in Romans 16. So, this is a big topic. And when I went to Africa, we had 2 or 3 days on sin, nature of Christ, and so on. It was very helpful for me. At that time, I hadn't heard much about it, but it really helped me. So I encourage you to study it for yourself. And I mean, some say it's the Christ had a nature before Adam, before the fall, or the Adam, the sinless Adam. But I think it's pretty clear it's not. And then you have the view of Christ coming to this earth as a man with the same nature as we have, and then it's one, the nature that we have when we have surrendered to Christ, and goes more into detail with the different different parts of our nature and so on. So study it, it's an important topic. This is how I see it right now, that God took, or Christ took our nature, as I read here in the quote, after when the race had been weakened for 4,000 years of sin, and he accepted the results of the working of the great law of heredity, and he came with such a heredity of the humans after 4,000 years of sin. But he did not sin. That's why some people believe that, you know, the sinful, they're mixing up the sinful nature with sin. But it's important that we make a distinction between it, because a sinful nature is not sin in itself. It's very important, because if not, there are two different sins, and I can't see it biblically. So this was just short, but you will see why this is important in relation to our topic. Let's see, and now we're going to go further. So let's take a look at the mystery of God unveiled. Romans 16, verse 25 and 26. Now to him that is of power to establish you according to my gospel, and the preaching of Jesus Christ according to the revelation of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began. Okay, we read about the secret. This mystery has been kept secret. But we also know that Revelation 13:8 says, the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. This was planned. This is part of the plan of salvation. Romans 16:26. Next verse. But now is made manifest, and by the scriptures of the prophets, according to the commandment of the everlasting God, made known to all nations for the obedience of faith. Here we start seeing a little bit the purpose of it. It's for the obedience of faith. Let's take a look. Here's also key text, Colossians 1, 26 to 29. I'm sure many of you have read it. These ones are straight to the point, what this is. Even the mystery, which has been hid from ages and from generations, but now is made manifest to his saints. Who was it hid for? Who was it hid for? It was hid from ages, it says. But who was it hid for? It was made manifest by the saints, but is this a hiding that is made purposely by God, you think? I think this is more for those, the Gentiles, and those that have no knowledge about it, because it says it is now made manifest to the saints. And of course you can say also that we see first when Christ came, that's when it started making sense more. The sanctuary service pointed to Christ, so that's another point that, but anyhow, let's continue the reading. Verse 27, to whom God would make known that is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. This is the mystery of God, and God wants to use us to make manifest the mystery of God, which is what? Christ in you, the hope of glory. Divinity manifest in humanity through Christ will now be made manifest in his saints, in God's people, because of Christ. So it has some different steps here we see. Verse 28, 29, whom we preach, warning every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect in Christ Jesus. That's the purpose. Because of Christ's sacrifice. Whereunto I also labor, striving according to his working, which works in me mightily. We can receive the character of God through the Spirit of Jesus, Christ living in us. So, this is the good news. The Father was manifest in Jesus, and Jesus in the flesh. Jesus can live in humanity, and we can take part of divine nature. This is what we have seen so far. And what is this? What can we call this with a theological term? Not too complicated. What is it that Christ lives in us and that will help us to become perfect? This is righteousness by faith, right? When we believe in Christ, we accept him, Christ will live in us and we will become perfected as long as we abide in him and he in us. So, Colossians 2, 1 to 3. There are many texts, so I'm reading through some of them here, and you're welcome to come and look them up, but for the sake of time. For I would that ye knew what great conflict I have for you, and for them that at Laodicea, and for as many as have not seen my face in the flesh, that their hearts might be conformed, being knit together in love, and unto all riches, of the full assurance of understanding, and the acknowledgement of the mystery of God, and of the Father, and of Christ, in whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Did you know that this letter, as read in verse 1, was going to be sent to Laodicea? This is an interesting detail here. Can it be that God's Spirit to Laodicea have not understood this very issue, the mystery of God? In verse 1, like I read, it says, actually in the end you see it, send this letter also to those in Laodicea. Let me read it for you so you have it. In Colossians, do you have it there? Maybe you can, I think it's in the end here. Yeah. But then in the end, it also says, in verse 16, 4, 16, now when this epistle is read among you, see that it is read also in the church of the Laodiceans, and that you likewise read the epistle from Laodicea. So, can it be that this message we found in Colossians, among all righteousness by faith, Christ in us, the mystery of God, that is to be fulfilled in the end times, in Laodicea? Can it be that Laodicea today does not understand it? And this is very important. I believe so. Because that's why we are Laodicea. If we would have had Christ in us, the hope of glory, we would not have been Laodicea. That's why we need it. That's why this message is so important. And we need to have this mystery. We need to experience this mystery. Let's take a look at this in the Old Testament. Because I made a research a little bit. I found the word mystery about 17 different places in the Bible, all in the New Testament. But we have read earlier that this was made known by the prophets. And how can that be? Because that's referring to the Old Testament. And I only found this about 17 places in the New Testament. But we have Romans 3:23. What does that say? Anyone know it by heart? For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. What's the glory of God? What do you think? His character, right? He created us in his image. And we have come short of the glory of God, of his character. Okay, here are some verses. Well, in Exodus 33, verse 18, Moses said, "Show me your glory. Show me your glory. I mean, I want to see you as a person." That's what he wanted to see. His character. So, in Habakkuk chapter 2, it says, "For the earth shall be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea." At what time do you think this is referring to? When is the whole earth going to be filled with God's glory? Because this is basically talking about the mystery of God. Because the mystery of God is what? Christ in you, the hope of glory, righteousness by faith. And we will get recreated into God's image. And in the Old Testament, he's using more the word glory, which is God's character, the same thing. Divinity made manifest in humanity. Through Christ, and then through his saints, that will make it manifest to the world. So it's going to be one point in history where God's character will be known through the characters of God's people. Because they know God. They have accepted Christ. They experience the mystery of God in them. Christ, the hope of glory. So, and this is really what will take place in the seventh trumpet, right? When the seventh trumpet shall sound, the mystery of God shall be finished. So there will be a time where God's people will experience the mystery of God. That's why Laodicea need to hear this. Psalm 72:19. This is why Laodicea needs to hear this message, because we are sleeping, we are not doing what we should do, but because the seventh trumpet will come in the end. We're gonna find out exactly when a little bit later. Psalm 72:19. "And blessed be his glorious name forever, and let the whole earth be filled with his glory. Amen and amen." Isaiah 60, here we have it on the screen. Isaiah 60, verses 1 to 3. Some of you would like to read this. Isaiah 60, verses 1 to 3. You can read it from the screen if you want, if you don't have it. Or maybe, okay, Joe, please.
"Arise, shine, for thy light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. For behold, the darkness shall cover the earth, and gross darkness the people. But the Lord shall rise upon thee, and his glory shall be seen upon thee. And the Gentiles shall come to thy light, and kings to the brightness of thy rising."
Okay, so we live in a dark world, and it will get darker. But what's going to happen according to this text? It says, "The glory of the Lord is risen upon thee, and his glory shall be seen upon thee." And in connection with other texts we have seen, this will take place at one point. The whole earth will be filled of his glory. All his people, through his people. And Elwine states here pretty clearly, the glory of God, the perfection of Christian character, is to be the aim, the purpose of our life. So, this is the mystery of God. So let's pause for a moment and see just a little bit. Like I said, God, what have happened? God created man in his image. Man fell into sin and lost the glory of God, lost his character, the reflection of his character. And since then, what has man been trying to do? We have been trying to make God's character fit into our image rather than opposite. You catch what I'm saying? I'm trying to say that, you know, many times we want God to fit into our lives. You know, I want to live my life like this. God, please bless this. Please come into my life. And we are not willing to let God form us like the potter of the clay. That's what God is all the time. He's trying to recreate us into his image. But we are saying, you know, God, be with me and, you know, accept my plans. And we're not saying that literally, maybe, but that's basically what we're doing when we refuse to surrender all to God. And also, well, he sent Christ to make this possible, to be an example, a perfect example. But God's people in history, the people of Israel, have been striving for so long to reflect again his character. But they failed again and again. And they tried to make God fit into their image rather than making their image fit, well, rather than letting God recreating them into his image again. And some examples, Exodus 19 verse 8, and this is about the let's see here, this is basically the old covenant. And all the people answered together and said, "All that the Lord has spoken we will do." And Moses returned to the words of the people unto the Lord. They were taking things into their hands. "We are going to do it." But they missed the point and they messed up. They broke God's covenant. He kept his part, his promises, again and again. But again, God's people messed up. The Israelites were to reveal God's character of love. And please come with me to Ezekiel chapter 36. We're going to read from verse 20. Because Ezekiel was one of the captives in Babylon, and it seems to have arrived the second time. Remember, I told you there were two times basically that Jerusalem was surrounded by Babylon. The second time, when the temple was destroyed, and so it was two times when they took people captives, and it is said that Ezekiel was one of the one from the second group, and they had brought the revelation of God's character in them to shame again and again. It says from verse 20, Ezekiel 36, "And when they enter unto the heathen, whither they went, they profaned my holy name. And when they said to them, 'These are the peoples of the Lord, and are gone forth out of his land,' but I had pity for mine holy name, which the house of Israel had profaned among the heathen, whither they went." So they had given a false perception of God to the world. Verse 22. "Therefore say unto the house of Israel, thus says the Lord God, I do not this for your sakes, O house of Israel, but for mine holy name's sake, which ye have profaned among the heathen, whither ye went. And I will sanctify my great name, which was profaned among the heathen, which ye have profaned in the midst of them. And the heathen shall know that I am the Lord, says the Lord God, when I shall be sanctified in you before their eyes." Like I said, they had messed up again and again, representing God, revealing his character. But did God give up with them? He tried again and again. And maybe you feel, man, I messed up badly, just like Israel. There is still hope for us because of Christ. He still wants to have a people that can represent his character. We have failed many times being a bad example. We have misrepresented God's name to the non-believers, to the believers. We have not let God recreate his character in us because we have been broken his covenant again and again, unfortunately. But regardless of our background, God wants to now transform us into his image. He's choosing a people despite of our errors. How great is not that? God is a God of mercy. And it's big enough that he loves us still, but he also died for us to save us. What an amazing love. So, God had, we can call it plan A, Adam and Eve in the great controversy. Did they fail? Obviously, yes. Unfortunately, yes, they did. They sinned, and then it went on. Plan B, Israel and God's people, did they fail? Well, I think we can say yes in AD 34. Which prophecy was fulfilled in AD 34? Which prophecy of Daniel, I can say, maybe it will help you. When Stephen was stoned, which prophecy was fulfilled? Yeah, you're into something there. Which prophecy was fulfilled when Stephen was stoned in the year 34? Correct. The Jews were no longer the people of God, which is which prophecy? 70 weeks, right. Daniel 9, 70 weeks. We're going to take some moment later and repeat, I hope, if we have time. Because these things are important. Okay, what is Plan C? Does God have a Plan C? Yeah. God's church. Has God's church failed? I think we can say yes to that. We have failed. And right now, God's remnant church is in a Laodicean condition, as prophesied. So we have failed, but have God given up his people, his church? No. I believe not. He hasn't. Because the prophecy takes it further. What will happen? John chapter 17, verse 18. Jesus says, "And thou hast sent me into the world," praying to his Father, "even so I have also sent them into the world." Okay. Christ has sent us on an important mission. Through his people, Christ is to manifest his character and the principles of his kingdom. The Lord desires through his people to answer Satan's charges by showing the results of obedience to right principles. If he says this, I mean, if the prophet of God says this, it must be possible then to show the results of obedience to right principles, obedience to the law. Of course, not in our own strength. Divinity was manifested in humanity. That's why this can work. That's why, if Christ dwells in us, it's Christ's work. Justification is Christ's work. Sanctification is Christ's work. Justification, that we are made righteous because of the blood of Jesus, and the Holy Spirit starts working in us. If you go to Titus, you'll find that out. Spirit starting a cleansing. And then we have a sanctification which continues to live a sanctified life, all because of Christ. Desire of Ages, page 761. The principles at stake were to be more fully revealed, and for the sake of man, Satan's existence must be continued. Man as well as angels must see the contrast between the prince of light and the prince of darkness. He must choose whom he will serve. So, it's just like some of you heard Rick Hovard when talking about the emergent church. You know, the reason why God allows this to his church is for all to make a choice. What do I mean, obviously he's allowing it, coming in. What do I want to choose? And seeing where it comes from, this is not good. So, again, in the great controversy, you know, man as well as angels, they need to see the contrast between the devil and his workings, sin and righteousness. Okay. Have you ever felt like you have been in a movie? Any one of you, like when you're somewhere doing something? I have felt that, and in particular a few times, and this is one of them. It was crazy. I, together with my good friend, we were going to America, and we had to have a layover in England. We had to switch airport. And here, this is in the middle of the night. We finally arrived to the airport, and there are like hundreds of these guys poking with sticks somehow in the ceiling. And we're like, what are they doing? And then everyone around, they were just like, it was like everyone knew what was going on except us. And we were just doing this. People were like on the sides, some were sleeping, and we were just, don't care so much. And then the fire alarm started. That's when it gets crazy. The fire alarm started, and a voice said in the speakers, "Please leave the building." No one reacted. Everyone just continued to do what they were doing. And here we are, like here, what are we going to do? No one is reacting. I mean, is this a movie or what? Are we inside a movie? That's how it felt. It was like everyone knew, like, okay, this is supposed to come. We're not going to do anything. And we were like, should we leave? Because no one else is leaving. Maybe it's a fire and no one cares. I mean, who knows? It was very weird. And, you know, as I said, we play a very important role in this great contrast. We are like on a theater scene. We are observed by the beings in the universe, by angels, by men, and so forth. So God, we are supposed to, I mean, the mystery of God is supposed to be revealed in the saints, as we have read. We play an important role in the end of this controversy. Okay. And by the way, God took a risk when he sent his son to the earth. Why? He took upon himself our nature. He was tempted. He could have fallen. And then again, God took a risk when he decided he wanted to use us as part of this great controversy for the whole universe to realize that God is indeed a God of love. He chose us. What a risk. Well, you can say God knows the future, so, well. But when Jesus was here on earth, I mean, it wasn't easy for him. If he was man, but at the same time God, I mean, it's, like I said, it's hard for us to understand, but he took a risk. Took a risk when he chose us. Jesus could have fallen. He didn't. Praise the Lord. When we see, look on Israel, how they have failed. It's easy for us to say, no, we can't do this because we look back. But we need to have the right focus. We need to have the focus on Christ. That's the only way how we can succeed. And let's go to Ephesians. We're soon going to take a break. I don't want you to get confused, but at least I got some comments. So I can say, sin is the transgression of the law. Jesus said you can sin in your mind with how you're thinking. It depends how you're thinking. It's not because you are. It's because you are making an action. It's because you have decided already of something in your mind. This can be sin when you get tempted and start dwelling on it. And you start, I mean, taking it further. You can commit adultery already in your mind, like Jesus said. It's not necessarily only. It's not only the act in itself, the physical act, but you can sin already in your mind. So, just want to make that clear. And again, I do not believe that your human sinful nature is sin in itself. We have to separate that from what sin is. Well, our human sinful nature is affected by sin for 4,000 years. Heredity, like Ellen White used it, for 4,000 years. And like I said, this is a big topic. This was not my original topic. That's why I'm not talking more about it. Like I said, study for yourself. Study. I would encourage you to study it. I don't think we can fully understand all things regarding this. It's hard. It's hard even for me to understand exactly how things work. That's why we will keep studying things in heaven. So, but it's an important topic, I believe. And what is sin? And also, what is the sinful nature? Okay. Ephesians chapter 3. Let's have another word of prayer before we start. So, Father in heaven, I thank you again that we can continue this study. And I pray that things may become clear to us throughout this study, and that your plan, how this takes part in your plan of the great controversy may get clear to us. Do we understand it? In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Okay, Ephesians chapter 3. And we're going to start in verse 8 to 10. So this is Paul speaking. To me, who am less than the least of all the saints, this grace was given, that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the ages has been hidden in God, who created all things through Jesus Christ, to the intent that now the manifold wisdom of God might be made known by the church to principalities and powers in heavenly places. So here we have Paul, that before was a legalist and a persecutor of God's people. He is counting himself as the least of the saints. He feels so unworthy. We see a big change in Paul. What happened? He has had a meeting with Christ, and that transformed him. So, the mystery of God was to be made known by the church to the universe. Despite all its failures, God wants to use it and raise it up and reflect him one day. And let's see in verse 13. Therefore I ask that you do not lose heart at my tribulations for you, which is your glory. So Paul, he was in prison many times. And he just counted it an honor to be persecuted. I mean, he knew that it was for Christ's sake. And despite all the tribulations, God can use this, and it can become the glory of God. So it's used to reveal this mystery, because look at Job. He was going through so much hard, and that must have been a horrible situation, but God allowed it, and it was for his glory. People may have wondered, how can you take it so well to Paul? They saw a change. They saw that he had a higher purpose. How can it be that Paul is sacrificing his life for this? You know, he used to be different, impatient, hateful. What happened? I briefly mentioned I was in prison in Israel for 3 days together with my friend here in May last year. They didn't let us in. Last class, we spent, I think, almost 2 hours sharing about this experience. And it's found on AFCO Europe's YouTube account. I don't know if I'll be able to share much on it later, but anyhow, we were not allowed into the country. They were suspicious, and you know, I had saved my beard to look more like them. I thought it would be positive, but it turned to be rather a curse, if you will. They treated us very bad. We came there, took away all our belongings, my medicine, just everything, and put us in there. We didn't know exactly how long we needed to be there. They were going to send us back. But then we thought maybe they were going to, I mean, we don't know. I was like, I don't know exactly how long I will stay here. I don't have my things. I don't have my medicine. Maybe they will find something to accuse us for. I don't know. It was very hard. We couldn't even bring our Bibles in there. But it was another Jew who was there, actually, a convert. He was allowed to bring the Jewish literature in there. We were not allowed to bring our Bibles. It was one of the hardest times of my life. I mean, we came in there like so bad hygiene in this place. And, you know, not even clean sheets. It was all dirty and like, okay, it was cold. We were going to stay there. It got colder during the night. And I was so hungry. I had not been eating the whole day. Didn't get any food, barely water. Next, I had to go to bed. A pain in my back. I was so tired, so hungry. Oh, that was, I didn't know how long I would be there. And it was a big, big thing in the media in Sweden and Norway. And the first page of the biggest newspaper in Sweden, a picture and text, and television and other newspapers wrote about this. Because my friend, he works at the Swedish television as a meteorologist, so everyone knows him. So then they made it a little bit bigger. But we just cried out to the Lord in there. And I was happy for every single Bible text I had memorized. They treated us very bad, you know, just the things they said. And we didn't know exactly how we would get out of there and what would happen. And yeah, I could tell you a lot, but we'll see if there's time later. But we got out. We managed to get book a ticket and get out earlier. That was nice. Then we didn't have to spend the Sabbath in there. But the point is, God allows tribulations and trials for our good. He, you know, he's using it to reveal God's glory in us. And we can be thankful for it, even though it can be hard sometimes to be thankful when you are in a hard situation like that. But if we see things, trying to see things in God's perspective, it will make more sense. Maybe we won't get answers to things, or I'm sure there are several things we won't get answered to until Jesus comes back. But as believers, something has changed us. And just like people probably ask, or Christians, they probably ask regarding Paul. People asked regarding us, non-believers. They read his story in the newspaper and other places. How could you take it so well? So what is the story? Now we are Christians. In other words, what is it that you have that it looks like I don't have? People started getting curious. And most likely we'll write a book about this experience. Many have encouraged us to do so, but already in prison we decided, let's write a book. Okay, a few verses more from Ephesians, from 17 to 21. That Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and the length and the depth and height, to know the love of Christ which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that works in us, to him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus to all generations forever and ever. So, when we believe in Christ and it takes place in our hearts through faith, this will serve as a foundation of our Christian experience. Christ abiding in us. And because of Christ's love, we may be able to experience and be filled with all the fullness of God. And God wants to be glorified in his church by a people that reflects him. And the question is, do you want to be part one of those that will reflect him? In John, 1 John chapter 3, verse 1 to 3, it says, behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Before the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it does not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be what? We shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is, and every man that has this hope in him purifies himself, even as he is pure. Behold what manner of love. Can you see it? When he shall appear, we shall be like him. When he shall appear, the mystery of God shall be finished. Christ in us, the hope of glory. And he has given us an example of sinless life, it says in, like we read in the Side of Ages, page 48. And this is only possible through Christ. So being like Christ, We need to love like him, care for others like him, work like him. When Moses had been at the mountain with the Lord for 40 days, how did his face look like? It was shining, right? He had seen God. He had seen part of his glory. And can we too shine like that? I believe so, and this will take place in God's church. Jesus, he's talking actually a little bit about this in some of his parables. I'm just going to read briefly from Mark 4:11. And he said unto them, "Unto you it is given to know the mystery of the kingdom of God. And unto them that are without, all these things are done in parables." This is the parables, parable referring to, you know, the man that was sowing seeds in the different places, different grounds. And here's like a summary in verse 20. He says, "And these are they which are sown on good ground, as such as hear the word of God and receive it and bring forth fruit." It's not just accepting the truth. So basically, some 30-fold, some 60, and some 100. So the point is, they're bearing fruit. If it's sown in the right ground, it will become fruit. And this is because of Christ. Christ in us. So righteousness by faith. And we also see, you know, the fruits of the Spirit will be evident if we let Christ abide in us and us in him. So we need to pray for the Holy Spirit. Pray for the latter rain. Isaiah 51:7. "Hearken unto me, ye that know righteousness, the people in whose heart is my law. Fear ye not the approach of men, neither be ye afraid of the revilings." So it's about having the law in our hearts. Jesus came to save us from our sins. We see in Matthew 1:21. And here's another quote from Christ's Object Lessons page 415. "It is the darkness of misapprehension of God that is enshrouding the world. Men are losing their knowledge of his character. It has been misunderstood and misinterpreted. Those who wait for the bridegroom's coming are to say to the people, 'Behold your God.' The last rays of merciful light, the last message of mercy to be given to the world, is" what? "A revelation of his character, of love. The children of God are to manifest his glory in their own life and character. They are to reveal what the grace of God has done for them. The light of the Son of Righteousness is to shine forth in good works, in words of truth and deeds of holiness." So, that was a pretty clear quote. A revelation of his character, of love. That's the last message of mercy. And the world is losing the knowledge of God's character more and more. So the church has to show, we need to put up the standard and see, through Christ's help, of course, to reveal his character, God's character. So this is quite practical. We know in Revelation 14, verse 12, that it says, "Here's the patience of the saints. Here are those that keep the commandments of God and have the testimony the faith of Jesus." It's Revelation 12:17. It says the testimony of Jesus. So the faith of Jesus, keeping his commandments. So God's end-time people will preach Christ's righteousness through their character and with their mouth. Their lives are going to be a testimony. In trials, Christ will shine forth. In hardship, Christ will shine forth. Ellen White makes this statement in the letter here: "I know that the work you are engaged in is the very work that should be done in connection with the third angel's message. As the hand is connected with the body, I have no fears of workers who are engaged in the work presented in the 58th chapter of Isaiah." So she connects this the third angel with a message in Isaiah 58. And let's take a brief look what we can find in Isaiah 58. And we are just going to read from verses 6 to 8. Just wanted to see it more practically, you know, righteousness by faith, a little bit more practical. Is not this the fast that I have chosen? To loose the bands of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, and to let the oppressed go free, and that ye break every yoke? Is it not to deal thy bread to the hungry, that thou bring the poor that are cast out to thy house? When thou seest the naked, that you cover him, and that thou hide not thyself for thine own flesh. Then shall thy light break forth as the morning, and thine health shall spring forth speedily, and thy righteousness shall go before thee. The glory of the Lord shall be thy reward. So you see here, this is basically the work of Christ. He meets the needs of the hungry, the naked, and break heavy burdens, and so on. And it says, when you do this, the righteousness shall go before thee. The glory of the Lord shall be thy reward. So this is righteousness by faith. This is how the mystery of God will be unveiled. And here's another statement from Ellen White regarding the third angel again and justification by faith. The Lord, in his great mercy, have sent a most precious message to his people through elders Wagner and Jones. This message was to bring more prominently before the world the uplifted Savior, the sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. It presented justification through faith in the surety. It invited people to receive the righteousness of Christ, which is made manifest in obedience to all the commandments of God. All power is given into his hands, that he may dispense rich gifts unto men, imparting the priceless gift of his own righteousness to the helpless human agent. See, this is not our work, it's God's work through us. This is the message that God commanded to be given to the world. It is the third angel's message, which is to be proclaimed with a loud voice and attended with the outpouring of the Holy Spirit in large measure. So this makes it pretty clear what righteousness by faith is and what the third angel's message is all about. Okay. So we have some text left, and then we will look at when it will be finished, and then we're done with this. Okay. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12. Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. So we can expect hardship if we live. If Christ abides in us, don't expect persecution, trials. Job 23, verse 10, like I referred to, but he knows the way that I take. When he hath tried me, I shall come forth as gold. God will refine us like he refined Job. And here's a very beautiful verse, I think, in Romans 8, verse 18 to 19. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creature waited for the manifestation of the sons of God. You know, this is the reward. Christ's righteousness that shall be revealed in us if we keep going through hardships. And praise the Lord for that. I'm looking forward to that. So this will produce a character. Trials will help us to produce a character, and it will reflect God one day. So we need to consider this rich reward that we have of the eternal world. And the new covenant is to have this is basically to have God's law in our hearts, in our minds. And we saw that there will be questions in the universe that needs to be addressed, that needs to be answered, and part of this will get answered by the recreation of characters. And the thing is, imagine if the angels, they've experienced, they're in heaven, they've experienced when Satan fall and rebelled, when sin arose, they want to be sure that no one that comes to heaven again will bring Sid with them. That wouldn't be a safe place. So they want to see that those who are going there are sealed. Those who are going there have Christ living in them. In the book Amazing Grace, page 235, the grace of Christ must mold the entire being, and its triumph will not be complete until the heavenly universe shall witness habitual tenderness of feeling, Christ-like love, and holy deeds in the deportment of the children of God. So, it's not going to be complete until the universe will witness this, a Christ-like love, holy deeds. And you know, this goes along with the sanctuary message. Because this will take place at the end of time, that the mystery of God will be finished. What else will be finished that we have studied in Daniel chapter 8? At some point, well, the judgment, the investigative judgment started, the cleansing of the sanctuary started in 1844. This will also at one point be finished, and this is cleansing the sanctuary from our sins. So, we can't, there will come a time where God's people, we will not keep sinning. When we let Christ abide in us, and we hold on constantly to his strength, then the sanctuary can be cleansed. Because, it can't be completely cleansed until God's people say, look, I'm going to follow Christ's example fully. I'm going to accept him in my life. I'm going to let him take control every day. It's going to come a time when the sanctuary will be cleansed. And when we completely can, God's last generation can prove to the universe that Christ indeed is love, and he is able to recreate us into his image again. And when he comes, the only thing that will be changed is our bodies, the glorification. That's the only biblical thing that we read of that will be changed. You will get new bodies. That's what the Bible says. It doesn't talk about our characters, because now is the time, as we have seen again and again in these Bible verses and quotes. That's what God is dealing with right now. Just as he's cleansing the heavenly sanctuary, we are living temples for God, that he is also now cleansing and refining. But you will find people out there that are saying, no, you can't become perfect here on this earth. I even hear people saying this, that the Bible is clear on that, but I think rather the opposite. It is indeed clear that we have to, and by these quotes. So it's a very important topic, and for the great controversy. Okay, some more quotes, and then we'll get to sum this up and find a time for when this is actually taking place. The rejecters of his mercy reap that which they have sown. God is the foundation of life, and when one chooses the service of sin, he separates from God and thus cuts himself off from life. He is alienated from the life of God. Christ says, all they that hate me love death. God gives them existence for a time that they may develop their character and reveal their principles. This accomplished, they receive the results of their own choice. By life of rebellion, Satan and all who unite with him place themselves so out of harmony with God that his very presence is to them a consuming fire. The glory of him who is love will destroy them. At the beginning of the great controversy, the angels did not understand this. Okay, So what needs to take place? Had Satan and his host then been left to reap the full results of their sin, they would have perished. But it would not have been apparent to the heavenly beings that this was the inevitable result of sin. A doubt of God's goodness would have remained in their minds as evil seed to produce its deadly fruit of sin and woe. But not so when a great controversy shall be ended. Then the plan of redemption, having been completed in the character of God, is revealed to all created intelligences. The precepts of his law are seen to be perfect and immutable. The sin has made manifest its nature, Satan his character. Then the extermination of sin will vindicate God's love and establish his honor before the universe of beings who delight to do his will and in whose heart is his law. From the Desire of Ages, page 764. So, in other words, just as God's people will reveal something important in the Great Controversy, will reveal God's character, those who go on Satan's side will also prove that they are, their rebellion will remain. The sin, they are not willing to give it up. So men and angels have free will. The universe needs to understand how awful sin is, so that it will never happen again. This is why the Great Controversy needs to end like this, and why this is important, the mystery of God. And the universe needs to understand and see God's character through us. So why is this not over yet? Well, why it says, Christ's Obligations, page 69. And now you have studied this in your devotions, so you have heard it. Christ is waiting with longing desire for the manifestation of himself in the church. When the character of Christ shall be perfectly reproduced in his people, then he will come to claim as his own. Not before, not after, at the time, right? At the time when the character of Christ shall be perfectly reproduced in his people. That's the time when he will come and claim them as his own. In other words, we can hasten his coming if we go to work. If we accept Christ and by our lives will reflect him more and more. Let's see. Yeah, well, it's talking about the these people, this multitude having a new song, practically a certain experience, and they were without fault, it says, Revelation 14, verse 3 to 5. And then we have in Revelation 7, verse 14, it says, here are those, these people had washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. And time, at one point, God will seal his people when they're ready. So here is, I'm going to give it kind of two summaries. One, here's one summary, and then one a little bit more practical. And this is actually from a quote, Desire of Ages 671. The Savior came to glorify the Father by the demonstration of his love. The Spirit was to glorify Christ by revealing his grace to the world. The very image of God is to be reproduced in humanity. The honor of God, the honor of Christ, is involved in the perfection of the character of his people. And here comes a little bit more practical summary, the things we looked at. We need to have Christ's character, the mind of Christ, letting him live through us by daily surrender. We need to love like Christ, helping the needy, feed the hungry, clothe the naked, take care of the poor, visit those in prison, and so on. This is what we read in Isaiah 58. It's actually keeping the Ten Commandments in practice. We love God, love our neighbor. Number three, let trials mold you. Let trials mold you. Because God is using them for this very purpose. He does not delight in them, but he's using them for this very purpose. And then share Christ through our characters and actions. Okay. Let's see. When will it be finished? By starting with, we saw in Revelation 10, that there will count, it says there shall be no, it should be time or delay no longer. And when is this? In verse 6 in Revelation 10. There should be delay or time no longer. And then he said, and this is the context when we come to verse 7, when it says, the mystery of God shall be finished when the seventh angel is sounding. So, the last time prophecy that we find in the Bible is the 2,300 days ending in 1844. And then White comments on that, and she says that the people will not have another message upon definite time. So, and referring to this, she's calling this prophetic time, it refers. And we also see in chapter 11, the context when it is sounding. So she says, she's referring, you know, to 1844, so we know this seems to be when it started. Let's see. Another context in Revelation, verse chapter 11, and from verse, I will read verse 15 to start with. It says, then the seventh angel sounded, and there were loud voices in heaven saying, the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdoms of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. An immediate look seems to, it seems to indicate that this is when Christ is coming, right? Well, he's actually coming right after this. But when the seventh angel, when does it start to sound? In the context, if we continue in verse 18 and 19, it says, the nations were angry, and your wrath has come, and the time of the dead, that they should be judged. And then it goes on in verse 19, then the temple of God was opened in heaven, the ark of this covenant was seen, the temple, and there were lightnings, noises, thunderings, and earthquake, and great hail. So, I believe the mystery of God started, the seventh trumpet started in 1844. It's a project that is not ended yet. It started to sound. So, that means now is the time to get ready and let God do his job by revealing his character through us. So, and in the First Peter, in these verses here, it's talking about his salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. Talking about being, we need to be tried with fire. And then that his glory, the glory that will appear at the when Jesus, at the coming of Jesus Christ. And then from verse 10, listen to this. Of which salvation the prophets have inquired and searched diligently, who prophesied of the grace that should come unto you, searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ, which was in them, did signify when it testified beforehand the sufferings of Christ and the glory that should follow. Unto whom it was revealed that not only unto themselves, but unto as they did minister the things which are now reported unto you by them, that they preached the gospel unto you with the Holy Ghost sent down from heaven, which things the angels desire to look into. The angels of God have desired to look into this mystery through all ages. Now finally, when Jesus came, divinity was manifested in humanity, and then through Christ, and then through us. And then now in the end, you're still looking with eagerness to see this fulfilled. Christ in us, the hope of glory. There have been many texts that we have been going through, and some of them a little bit quickly, and some quotes. But I just wanted to show you that this is a topic spoken of in the Bible many places. The Old Testament, the New Testament, they're pointing to one point in history from 1844, when the seventh trumpet started, the mystery of God, Christ in us, that will be revealed in his church, through his church. The last quote here from A.T. Jones, The Consecrated Way, pages from 113 to 19, selected parts. It's not all of this. The finishing of this work, and this is also a good summary. For the sanctuary was likewise the finishing of the work for the people. The cleansing of the sanctuary extended to the people and included the people. As truly as it did the sanctuary itself. The finishing of the mystery of God is the ending of the work of the gospel. The taking away of all vestige of sin and the bringing of in of everlasting righteousness, Christ fully formed within each believer. God alone manifests in the flesh of each believer in Jesus. In the sanctuary itself, transgression could not be finished. An end of sins and reconciliation for iniquity could not be made until all this had been accomplished in each person who had a part in the service of the sanctuary. The sanctuary itself could not be cleansed so long as, by the confessions of the people and the intercessions of the priests, there was pouring into the sanctuary a stream of iniquities, transgressions, and sins. We talked about this. You know, as long as we keep sinning, I mean, they need to, the priests, well, in our case, Jesus Christ, he's cleansing the sanctuary. So what is it? And since this stream must be stopped at its fountain in the hearts and lives of the worshippers before the sanctuary itself could possibly be cleansed. Therefore, the very first work in the cleansing of the sanctuary was the cleansing of the people. The sacrifice, the priesthood, and the ministry of Christ is the true in the true sanctuary, thus take away sins forever, thus make the comers thereunto perfect, thus perfect forever them that are sanctified. So this is pretty much sums up also what we have talked about. And one verse here from Revelation 22, verse 4, and they shall see his face, and his name shall be in their foreheads. One day, we will get his name in our foreheads. This is a symbol of ownership and approval of God. And it signifies the yielding of the mind to intelligent and loyal obedience to all God's commandments, as Ellen White expresses it. During the Second World War, millions of Jews were taken. They were stuffed into these wagons here of the train, these box cars, as they're called. And not only Jews, but mostly, you know, many of them, they were suffocating to death in here. It was so packed, people were suffocating. And there was a father and a son. This was actually a Jewish prince. He was from a royal family. They went in here. Where they Gestapo found them, even though they were hiding, and put them in here. And people were suffocating before. Some were falling down dead during the trip. And they were, of course, going to one of these concentration camps. And the boy almost died. But the father, he was holding over and protecting him. And then the train stopped. They saw the sign. And they came to Ravensbrück, and they saw the sign, Arbeit macht frei. Work makes you free. And then you have they were divided into three groups. You had the elderly and the sick into one group. They were going into the gas chamber, died immediately. Then you have the younger people, they also into another gas chamber and died immediately. Then you have them into between that had some kind of health. They were going to work. And as they were parting, the father and the son, they were about to be separated. They were crying. The father looked in the eyes of the son, and he said these words, "Son, never forget that you are a prince. Never forget that you have royal blood running down through your veins. Never forget who you are. And to you, I want to tell, there's no accident that God has put you into his remnant church. for such a time as this. Never forget that you are created to reflect God's image. Never forget that He wants to recreate you into His image. Never forget who you are. Because of Christ's sacrifice, we can claim His blood. We can become like Him. We can be redeemed by Him. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Here's, here's one verse from the psalm, or the hymn, 598, Watch Ye Saints. Listen to the words. You know, and remember your royal blood through Jesus. Sinners, come while Christ is pleading. Now for you He's interceding. Haste ere grace and time diminished shall proclaim the mystery finished. Is it your desire to have, to reflect the glory to the world so we can go home? How many of you would like to reflect God's glory? Amen. Let's have a short prayer together. And Father in heaven, it's in all humility that we come before you, because we realize we have messed up many times as a people, as individuals. You have come with so many plans. You had a plan A. Adam and Eve, they failed. You had a plan B. The people of Israel, they failed. Now we have a plan C with your church. Father, we do not want to fail. We want, as we see these things from the Word, we want to hold on to you, Lord. We want to reveal your glory. But as we look at ourselves and the people around us and the people in the past, it looks impossible. But with you, it is possible. Please, Lord, I pray that we may experience Christ in us, the hope of glory, so that when you come, you may be reflected in your church. And may we be the generation that takes this gospel to the world, and that will be ready for you to come. I pray in Jesus' name, amen.